I will give a bit of Frankenstein-y talk in the sense that I will pull together different areas such as linear algebra, statistics, functional approximation. I will give you a little introduction on each, and actually the key idea of my research is to exploit the synergy of those. On the easier side, I will talk mostly about numerical computations. So my motivation is an area which has become popular quite recently, the so-called uncertainty quantification. So where it appears, for example, you might have a classical model, like a partial differential equations, but with some coefficients being not just the normal deterministic coefficients, but random field here. And as a result, so is the solution. So what you can do, you can then parameterize this uncertainty that is, for example, you can assume that this random field is Gaussian, and then you compute the Krahunin-Löf expansion or the Fourier expansion. And effectively, you turn your stochastic problem into a deterministic problem, but with many independent parameters. Or in principle, you can have deterministic parameters from the very beginning, as Albert Cohen presented in the morning. You can have something like uncertain squares in your domain. And as we heard many times today, our main enemy is the curse of dimensionality, because if you do a naive discretization in all these variables, we will end up with the exponentially many points. And of course, we would like to avoid this. But let's make the problem even more difficult. Because just solving the PDE for it is probably okay if you want to start. But when you really want to design a new engine, for example, or if you want to infer what is the distribution of your soil density, you need to solve the inverse problem. And the inverse problem we are thinking about are intrinsically stochastic, because you have this stochastic or now parametric PDE as a constraint. Okay, then you might have some data, and well, as many inverse problems I'll post. But because it's intrinsically stochastic, we can suggest one nice formalism. We will solve it in a Bayesian way. So what does it mean? So we have some model, like our PDE, which maps from the space of parameters to some Banach space X. Then we have some observation operator. For example, this can be evaluation of our solution at some points, or it can be integral over some subdomains, which maps it back to the real space. Then the real measurement would add some noise there, which we can for simplicity assume to be independent, identically distributed Gaussians. And we get our data, what we actually observe. So because we have all these random variables here and there, we don't consider just our actual measurements, our actual inference. We consider probability distributions instead. So we always work with the probability distribution. For example, we can assume that our parameters satisfy some prior, like uniform or Gaussian, as I said. Then the data likelihood basically turns into the exponential of minus residual up to some scaling factors. And then the Bayes theorem tells us that the posterior density is basically a product of the likelihood in the prior. And the ultimate task, if you want to solve the inverse problem, now we want to get some deterministic quantity. Basically, all we need to do is to compute these two integrals here. So we need to compute the so-called normalization constant of our posterior density, then we integrate our quantity of interest with this posterior. The only problem, but the really challenging problem, is that these integrals are high dimension. So we need to approximate them numerically somehow. And of course, we can't imagine that all of these functions will be integrable analytically in all cases. So, okay, now some beautiful pictures, because not many of us are statisticians here. So here is our task. Actually, this task is the most difficult. And assume our probability density looks like this. Just not very difficult, but there are some features. For example, it's pretty narrow in one direction, but it's wide in another direction. And it's actually high dimensional, so there is just a two-dimensional slice, probably in the first two variables. Then as a quantity interest, we a desperately waiting phenomenon. What is the probability that the second parameter is greater than the first one? Just imagine this. Then, okay, we know we can plot it as an indicator function here. So we basically need to integrate the product of these two functions, right? What we can possibly do, okay, it's a high dimensional integral. We can use, for example, a Monte Carlo quadrature. The difficulty is, of course, that you see that all points here are discarded, all points in the white areas. And in fact, all points here are discarded because here the probability density is zero. So only this fraction of points make any contribution to our estimate. And of course, it's not what we would like to. Of course, this effect is worse in higher dimensions. Then we can try to suggest some more rapidly convergent quadratures, something like the sparse grids. But okay, we still have an argument that many points are wasted. But further on, we don't have smoothness of this function here. The product of this function is not smooth. It's not even continuous. So probably it's not a very good idea to use techniques which explicitly employ smoothness in there. We can, of course, try to introduce something like a tensor product grid, but then face the curse of dimensionality. And still, I mean, it's a question how rapidly they will converge. So we can look at this from the very other perspective. We can simulate the nature in a sense. What we can try to do, we can try to start somewhere and then cook up an algorithm which will walk around our high dimensional space and stay most of the time where our function of interest has large values, very regularly speaking. So the family of algorithms of this kind was called Markov chain Monte Carlo methods, and they become extremely popular exactly because potentially they can cope with any probability distribution function quantity of interest. But there are other problems because if you would try to do big jumps from one point to another, quite often we will end up with the areas of very low probability. And these points will be rejected. We can do the other way. We can move very slowly. In this case, it's more robust. For example, here we really move slowly around all these points here. But of course, if we move slowly, then the number of points we need to approximate this quadrature here may be huge. The larger, the slower we move. So the statistician know that it's quantified by the so-called integrated autocorrelation time. But speaking for general audience, that's something like this. There are ways to improve the situation. You can use the gradients of the function. But in principle, our ideal wish would be something like this. So ideally, we would like to have independently distributed samples lying along our target probability density. And in fact, that's what I'm going to do. So now I'm going to use the Markov chain Monte Carlo idea, but I want to assist it with using the tensor product decompositions, the area I developed for something like 10 years by far. But first, let's introduce some basics on it. So having a function here, what we do first, we discretize it independently in each variable. So we do this very naive approach, which would give us the curse of dimensionality potentially. And of course, if we don't do anything else, we would really get the curse of dimensionality. And because we would have now a d-dimensional tensor of the discrete values. But what we trying to do generally, we try to approximate it with some of reasonably modest number of products of univariate factors there. Because now here after discretization, we can only store these univariate factors basically. And have the number of discrete values linearly proportional to the dimension. And then we can also integrate the right-hand side easily because we just compute one-dimensional integrals. So that's good. The really key issue here, well, there are actually two issues. The first issue is what are these auxiliary indices here precisely, because it might be not just single index, but a set of indices in fact. And the second issue, of course, is how would we compute all this? Because I can write any formulas, but can we actually calculate them somehow? So for the beginning, I want to start with something simple, just a function of two variables. Just very simple linear algebra, actually. So if we have a function of two variables, we discretize it independently, we end up with a matrix. And what we want to do, we want to approximate it by a low rank matrix. And the low rank matrix can be stored factor by factor with a significant cost reduction. And we also know that there is a singular value decomposition which gives an optimal approximation error for the given rank. So the SVD is good, but it's not very good because in fact, the matrix may be so huge that it doesn't fit into the memory. And when we will extend it to high dimensional tensors, they will practically always be the case. So what we want to do instead, we want to design an algorithm which can reconstruct directly these factors here using a reasonable amount of inquiries into the function, using a reasonable amount of samples from the function. So and the idea traces back to some classical interpolation. And the relation between the minimization and the interpolation. So the SVD minimizes the error, but what we want to do instead of the truly minimizing the error, we might want to interpolate it. We might want to choose some set of values I and ask for a precise equality at this set, in this set of rows, this set of columns. This basically means that we approximate our matrix by a Lorentz decomposition, which now looks like this. But obviously, the number of entries from the matrix is much smaller. So it's the number of entries in the two factors. So this equation is feasible to compute. More questions appear, as always. The questions are, what are these index sets here? What they should be? And not just like what they should be in general, what are the best possible values here? And what values we can actually compute? Because it adds up, it's not the same. And then we'll come to the questions how all this extends to more than two variables. So the answer about the best indices is reasonably known. If you select them such that the submatrix on the intersection has the maximum volume, and the volume is the absolute value of the determinant. If the submatrix has the maximum volume among all R by R submatrices, then we know that the approximation error is only by a factor proportional to the rank worse than the optimal approximation error. The problem is that it's an exponentially hard to look through all R by R submatrices of an N by N matrix. And I am too impatient to wait for computers becoming fast enough to cope with that, for them to becoming that fast. So I need a different approach. And the approach which has actually become a workhorse in working with different tensor product decomposition is the alternating iteration. So what does it look like? We can assume that given some initial set, let's say we are given some random indices of this range. What we can do, we can compute columns, of course, because there is just R columns and a feasible number of elements. And what we do next, we take this factor here, and we start deriving some optimal indices. So the question is now, what are the optimal indices? Well, so each factor is a rectangular matrix, quite clearly. So with this range R, in this range, let's say N. And instead of looking for an R by R submatrix in the entire big matrix, we look for an R by R submatrix in this matrix, just this factor. And of course, this problem reduces to the problem of selecting R rows, some R rows here. The rows which give the submatrix of the maximum absolute determinant. And this problem is actually feasible now because, for example, it starts just with the LU decomposition with the row pivoting. So let me use a different color here. So in the first step, for example, we look for the maximal and modulus element in the first row. Then we look for the maximum modulus element in the Schur complement and then so on and so on. So when you go to the end, there are a few other rank one corrections, but you end up with the matrix with the maximum volume property in the factor. And then you alternate. So then you have these optimized indices here. And now you compute the set of rows on these new indices, right? Then you can transpose the rows and get up into the same rectangular matrix. Apply this algorithm again and so on, so on. So what you do in each step, you maximize the volume in the factor. But in fact, you know that this also maximizes the volume in the regional matrix. So if I write here the determinant of this intersection matrix here, modulus, and here I write the iteration number. So what I actually have, you have an increasing sequence of the absolute determinant of the intersection matrix. So it's monotonously increasing because that's what you achieve in each step. And it's obviously bounded from above by the true maximum volume of the very optimal matrix. So somewhere there is the true maximum volume. So obviously you have a monotonous sequence bounded from above, so it converges. So the one good result, this algorithm converges. Pinch of salt here is what does it converge to? Because what may actually happen here is that you actually end up at some volume lower than the truly optimal one. And unfortunately, there is no general theory for that. In fact, it's very easy to construct a counterexample. For example, what you can do, you can cook up a function which has two modes. And you can say that your initial index sets all lie along one of the modes. And there is an area here of precise zeros. So in this case, you would never recover the second mode. So this is a bad side, but of course, we must assume that the function has some structure. So today we saw many talks which assume that the function is rich, that the function is effectively low dimension. Honestly, I'm a bit pessimistic about very general methods for high dimensions. So it must be a heuristic at some point, otherwise it's probably a bit cheaty. But what we can assume generally if we throw our initial samples at random, what we can normally assume is that not like this, but instead they are reasonably uniformly arranged. And if that's the case, an empirical practice is that the cross iteration algorithm would converge to close to optimal approximation for the given rank and in reasonable amount of iterations. So we don't need to wait for years. Just wait for it to load. So there are some improvements here, but they're basically related to numerical stability in machine precision. For example, before applying the row pivot in NDLU decomposition, you can compute QR rectangularization of the factor, or you can expand the factor with some random columns or some surrogate of the R. And in this case, you can possibly increase the rank if it was insufficient in the initial iteration. In fact, I don't want to be that detailed, and I want to talk on some other high-level things instead. But the good thing to know is that the idea of a cross-interpolation was discovered and applied heavily in other communities, for example, integral equations or model load reduction. So in principle, it's some mature methodology. And now we want to use it in higher dimensions for approximating posterior density functions in particular. Right, so in high dimensions, of course, it's all nice about matrix approximations. So we really want to exploit them. And here is the ansatz we are going to use. So what we have here, we have sum of products of univariate factors there. And now, as I said, these auxiliary summation indices, they don't have to be the single index. In fact, in this case, there are d minus one indices, but the key point is they are structured. And this representation here was invented multiple times, again, in physics and in numerical mathematics, and particularly in numerical mathematics, it was called the tensor train, because the structure of these auxiliary indices looks like couplers in terrain. Because, for example, the first index appear in only two blocks, in the first and second block. The second index appear in the second and the third block, and so on and so on. So it really couples these blocks of unknowns. Here you can see them. And then you can simply count the number of variables each block depends on. And you see that the answer is 3. And 2 for the border element, for the border blocks. So in the right-hand side, you deal with three-dimensional tensors at most, which is good. And then, of course, you have these rank values, so the range of these auxiliary indices. And the goal of computations is, first of all, to choose applications where these ranges are modest, but also maybe to design algorithms such that they really exploit the case when these ranks are small. If they are small, then the storage reduction can be massive. It's again linear in the dimension, linear in the one-dimensional grid size. And in one-dimensional grid size, you can choose any good grid you can think of, like Chebyshev or Hermite. And then rank squared. This is something you need to live with, but you might potentially want to optimize this. Okay, as I said, I can write potentially any representation I like, but the question is really, can I compute efficiently there? So let's see how we can design the cross-interpolation idea for the tensor-train decomposition. And for simplicity, let's try it doing for three variables. So now we have more indices. So let me assume that we are given two sets. So first we are given some subset of the third index, and then we have a subset of the last two indices, actually. Because if that's the case, I can compute n times r samples and get the first DT block. And I introduce a bit of a shorthand. Let me write it down because I will also use it later. So whenever I write something like u of I k j, this actually means that I take a tuple of values from the first index, so it will be u. So this is now the original function. And then I take I1, ik minus 1 from the subset I. Then I take the full range of ik. And then I take the remaining indices from the subset of j. So this will be really necessary here. Let me even clean it up a bit. Because switch set I or j here, so or j with some subindex here, each element of this set is actually a vector of variables, variables corresponding to the coordinates. And you see, so this is shorthand, is nothing else than evaluating the original function or the original tensor at some values there. So when we have this, that's fine. So now this is a rectangular matrix, just the same way like this. We can compute the pivots, maximize the determinant. Then we compute the second TT block using exactly these formulas. Now we have an update in these indices, reduced range of these indices. We take the full range in the second index and the reduced range in the third index here. You see how many functional evaluations we have here. And then we want to derive the new set of pivots. So this is the most difficult part here, actually. The rest of the talk will really be simpler. So what does happen here? So remember that each TT block, like U2, in the third line there, is a three-dimensional tensor. So I can draw it like as a cube. And now what I want to do, I want to slice it in one of the directions, for example, this one. So I take the slices. And each of the slices is a matrix, because it's a table of, it's a two-dimensional table of values. So then I take these slices here and stack them one after another. So actually this rectangular matrix, in this rectangular matrix now, again, but the row index is not just a blind row index, but it inherits this two-varied structure from the three-dimensional tensor. But since this now a rectangular matrix again, nothing prevents me from applying the LU decomposition or the maximum, the volume optimization algorithm. But what ends up, because I do have this two-varied structure here, what I obtain actually is that my new set I2 contains a sub-range of I1 and I2. It contains a sub-range of the first two variables, which means I can plug it together with I3 into the original function and get the third block. And you see that the number of samples is even linear in the rank here. And that's, in fact, that's all. It's not much, it will be the same in arbitrary number of variables because the highest dimensionality I have to deal with is three. It's a single TT block here. And in principle, if a function is regular enough, the single iteration like this may be sufficient to recover good approximation. For example, the solution of the diffusion equation introduced at the beginning might be recovered with a sufficient accuracy if the coefficient is a smooth enough random field, and the number of indices here is large enough. Just the single iteration like this will give you a decent TT approximation. Of course, in a general case, especially if you want to approximate the probability density function, and especially if it's localized somewhere, what we might want to do, we want to carry out several iterations like such. So we want to iterate back in a sense and compute the right sets of indices in the same way. So this is it. For arbitrary dimension, the pseudocode is practically the same. So you compute your function on n times r squared entries. Then you perform some linear algebra to derive new index sets. You don't inquire the function anymore, actually. And then you move to the next block. So you go either one direction or another direction. You switch the direction when you reach the end of the tensor training decomposition. The thing here is that we need the number of function evaluations, which is linear in the dimension, linear in the one-dimensional grid size, quadratic in the rank, times the number of iterations as well. But if you can come out with something like three, five iterations, that's usually small enough. So in principle, you might, if you remember Sandra's talk, so she had to evaluate n times d values of the projector. I have different notations, but the idea in some sense similar. So I need to evaluate some polynomial number of evaluations. And that's it. So this way I can potentially approximate any function because I can potentially take these ranks as large as I want. Of course, it's only efficient if the ranks are small, but theoretically nothing prevents me from choosing them large and trading the computational cost for accuracy. And I said already that it's really crucial that this algorithm explores the entire range, at least in one variable. So it's not just a set of random points. It really goes along the full range in one variables, and then it can optimize the next indices it will use to learn the function. Generally, it would be good, of course, to prove some more theorems here, possibly with probabilistic estimates, but at the moment, well, probably I'm too lazy, probably I'm not an expert in compressed sensing. I couldn't come up with any, but practically, this algorithm works very well in many cases. And now let's get back to my original task. So because my original task was not even to compute this approximation for the sake of approximation, my original task was about producing samples of some probability density function. So why I spent all this length explaining you the TT cross algorithm is mostly because once you have a TT decomposition, the rest is practically straightforward. I will show you in a bit. So the first thing, there is a little change of notation because we can say, okay, we seem to be computing the forward map of our PDE model, or we need to compute the probability density function. Well, the answer is we really need to compute both. In principle, we can gain further cost gain if we first compute the solution and then plug it into the function that produces the probability density because By solving the PDE, you can exploit some model reduction ideas, and then in computing them. Probability density, you can leverage that you compute a TD decomposition of another TD decomposition. So it's easier than an ad hoc approximation. But in principle, given any closed form expression of your probability density function, you can just run this algorithm ad hoc. So now back to sampling for integrating the Bayesian posterior expectation. The answer to this question was actually suggested something like 60 years ago. So we can write the probability density function into a product of conditional densities, just by definition of conditional density. And this allows us to produce samples coordinate by coordinate. So basically, in each step here, we sample from this conditional density in the kth variable conditioned on all the previous coordinates. And if you start from the beginning, we have a recursion. So first we compute the first variable. It doesn't depend on anything else. And then we condition the second term to the first values, sample the second variable, and so on, so on. We can observe that if you fix these values here, that this conditional density is nothing else than the marginal density up to a constant, basically up to the previous value of the, all the previous conditions. And you can possibly remember, again, the talk by Albert Cohen, that this algorithm is called the conditional probability sampling, if you exploit this. Or, in fact, it has multiple names, because first, Rosenblatt wrote a four-page note about the transformation of a probability space from a uniform on a cube into your desired probability space with the measure pi. And then it was called the conditional distribution method by DeRoy, Horman, and other people. And it's also called inverse cumulative method sometimes. So the idea how it goes is it computes the marginal density in the first variable, so just the univariate density, then it's easy to sample. You can use spline interpolation, polynomial interpolation, then you can use the Newton method to invert the cumulative function. In one dimension, all these things are easy and never a bottleneck. Then you write the recursion, and in the case step, we need to condition our joint density to the previous k minus one components. We need to integrate out last d minus k components, and then we sample the kth component itself. Problem. The curse of dimensionality is still here, because you need to integrate these variables here. In the first step, it's just one variable less than d. So in principle, if you can compute these integrals analytically, that's the good way to do. But we can't really count on that, and we want to introduce a numerical scheme. And this is exactly where we will use the tensor terrain approximation of the probability density. Because if you have a tensor terrain decomposition of pi, then conditioning the first k minus one variables is nothing else than the univariate conditioning of the TT blocks. Integrating the last d minus k variables is nothing else than one-dimensional integration, the set of one-dimensional integrations. And then, okay, we have just a single TT block in between, so we need to multiply it with these conditionals here and these integrations here, and then we get our univariate density. And of course, as in the original conditional sampling method, we go from the first variable to the last. So actually, we have this alternative iteration idea, the very same. And if you compute the cost now, it ends up linear in the number of samples you want to produce, the number of these points here. And then linear in the dimension, quadratic in the rank, linear in the one-dimensional grid size. Most importantly are the first two things, this linearity here. So as I said, from the one-dimensional distribution, you can derive samples by whatever one-dimensional algorithm you like. Then, again, a new pinch of salt here. Probably, I don't like going back in slides, but now it's really time to. So the rank, so the dependence in the rank, the really nasty thing here, because In order for this algorithm to be fast, you want, of course, the rank to be as small as possible, obviously. But you can't just make it arbitrarily small because it depends on your function. What function you want to approximate. But in principle, it turns out that what you can do is you can really use a mixture of different methodologies at this point. Because if you look, for example, at the TT error, the error of your TT approximation versus the rank. And this will be the logarithmic scale. So let me write it precisely, logarithm. So what can actually happen quite often is that it decays steeply enough in the beginning, but at some point, the rate becomes slower. So what you really might want to exploit, you want to exploit this fast decay in the beginning, and really not going further in approximating, in PDE approximation than something like this good convergence here. But of course, now this threshold here may be too coarse compared to your desired accuracy in your posterior expectation, right? It can be, for example, just 10%. So in this case, I really want to use another algorithm to improve the situation. So problem, we sample from an approximate distribution, not the actual distribution we need. So and the idea is to use this conditional distribution samples as proposals in the standard Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithm. So we produce a point from our conditional distribution, then we plug it in into the metropolis ratio and accept or reject this point. The good thing compared to some working Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithms that these samples here are independent. So potentially you can do it in parallel, but you can also prove that if you have a bounded error in the TT approximation, then the rejection rate will be proportional to it. And the complement of the autocorrelation time to one will be proportional to the TT approximation error, which is good because it means that by computing an accurate approximation, you can produce an almost ideal Markov chain. Further on, you can think about even better than Monte Carlo, because the Monte Carlo converges according to big numbers law, which is probably annoyingly slow. So we know that there are the techniques, for example, quasi-Monte Carlo lattices, which are easy enough to generate on a unit cube. But then you can actually map them through this conditional distribution algorithm, because all it needs to do is to compute the one-dimensional inverse cumulative function on some seed points. The seed points in the Markov chain in Monte Carlo, they were random values from 0 to 1. But we can replace them by the QMC values instead. And here is some beautiful picture how these colored QMC points look like. So you can expect a faster convergence, for example, with the rate 1 over n for sufficiently smooth function and sufficiently rapid decay of the influence of the variables. Problem. We have an high approximation error in the pi here. So, and we can't just reject quasi-Monte Carlo points because it's a deterministic set of points. We can't just do whatever we like with them. So and here we can use actually the multi-level Monte Carlo idea. I will explain in a simpler version of just two levels. So what we do, we want to compute an expectation with respect to our exact density. And we use some dull add and subtract trick. At this point, it's dull because just add and subtract an approximate expectation. But then we use different quadrature rules for different terms here. Like in the first term, we use the quasi-Monte Carlo rule, but with the approximate density here. It converges rapidly, but to a wrong distribution. To solve this problem, we add the correction here, where we use truly random values here. So we can reject them with the MCMC. And therefore, this correction will converge to the correction of the wrong distribution and the right distribution. But on the other hand, the magnitude, or to be precise, the variance of this term here is small because it's proportional to the error between these two distributions. So we can take the first number of samples in the first term small because it converges rapidly, but also the number of samples in the second term small because its absolute magnitude is much smaller than the magnitude of the first. In this way, we can again balance the cost and the accuracy in the two terms. Okay, the last 20 minutes, something, 18, 15. Right, a bit of numerical experiments, how it performs. So in the first problem is what I presented in some sense already. It's the, we have a diffusion equation as our forward model with some boundary conditions here. So we assume that our coefficient after parameterization already is given in the so-called log normal form. So it's exponential of some affine term. It does look like a rich function here, but not precisely, because you see these functions here are parameterized by another variable, by the spatial coordinate basically. So it's a bit, it's something rigid, but a bit more complicated. We want to simulate our measuring instrument by collecting average values in 9 points. Just some model problem, we need to try something. And we assume that our measuring instrument has the noise variance of 0.01. Then what we want to infer, in particular, we want to compute an average flux, an average posterior flux on the right boundary. Because, I mean, this is a model version of subsurface flow, so we might want to see how fast particles travel here. And in particular, what we might also want to compute, we want to compute the probability that the speed of this flux here is larger than some value. So, but first what I want to show, how the error and the posterior density function influences the parameters of the Markov chain. So first I need to introduce a discretization grid, as I said, because I want to compute it. So here I show the number of rejections in the Markov chain algorithm and the integrated autocorrelation time of the resulting chain versus the number of grid points in each direction and the stopping tolerance in the TT cross algorithm. So we see that both error indicators converge quadratically with respect to the reciprocal number of points because we just use linear splines. So potentially we can use some sophisticated one-dimensional approximations here, but just with the linear splines, we have the second order convergence as expected for the linear interpolation. And what's more important that that the error indicators converge linearly with respect to the number of, with respect to the approximation error. So we have a confirmation of our theorems, which is always good, I think. But now let's get to some more practical figures, because our goal is to compute the posterior quantities of interest. So what we can use here, for example, we can remember that the posterior quantity of interest is nothing else than the ratio of two integrals, two high-dimensional integrals. So we can just apply the quasi-Monte-Carlo lattice, generating using the prior Gaussian distribution to the denominator and denominator of the Bayes formula. Or we can use some reasonably sophisticated algorithm from statistics. It's called delayed rejection adaptive metropolis, which is general enough, in fact. And then we can use the conditional distribution sampler using the tensor train approximation. So we can just use it in two ways, in single level and two level version. And here what we have, so we plot the relative errors of the mean flux of the right boundary and the relative error of the exceedance probability that it falls below -5. So the mean value of the flux is about -4. So probably the absolute probability of this event is something about 0.1. And what you can see basically is that first, the DRAM curve is much higher than everything else because exactly it moves slowly along the high dimensional space and therefore it needs much higher number of points, of Monte Carlo points. Then if you compare the QMC and the standard TT with random samples, you can actually see that the flux itself, the QMC ratio estimator is faster. Because the flux is actually an analytic function of the solution, and then the likelihood is also analytic, so actually it exploits some faster convergence, that the big number is low. But if you look at the exceedance probability, which involves integrating an indicator function, the rate breaks down to n to the minus 1/2, really. And then the tailored samples distributing according to the actual density become faster. And even further, we can leverage the two-level correction. So if you can really plug it in some variance reduction from the cost we have already invested in the TT approximation, we can have some variance reduction by using these colored QMC points here. And basically, it goes lower than the single-level method everywhere. So far, so good. But what if you don't want to meddle with PDEs? If you just want to compute some ad hoc example, that's what statisticians like in particular, because you probably don't need mesh generators, preconditioners, solvers, always easy. So here is a model of estimating the failure time of a shock absorber. So what it does, it assumes a viable failure model. Don't ask me what exactly it means and why exactly it's chosen. And then its parameters are further extended into so-called hyperparameters. Basically, what happens here is that there are measurements of times when a shock absorber fails. Some of them are censored, which means that it may be arbitrarily larger than the measured time. What's important here for numerical analysis is that in the end, we have a closed form expression of the posterior density function. It's very lengthy, so I don't write it precisely here, but we can compute it at any point in RD. And the dimension here is 6 + 2, so it's 8. But potentially this part here can be extended to arbitrary dimension because these hyperparameters may account for the vibration intensity, the temperature, a model of car, who knows. You can really make them arbitrary. And we want to estimate the 95% quantiles on the right edge, so like some guarantee time that the shock absorber doesn't fail. And here are the results of the conditional distribution sample and DRAM. So first of all, in both methods, actually, we need to invest some upfront cost. So in the tensor train methodology is the number of evaluations we need in the TT cross. So here it's about 10 to 5. But in fact, in working Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithms, there's a thing called burn-in. It's the number of points which are distributed according to something else instead of your desired density. So when you run the DRAM algorithm, first it starts learning how does your function look like, actually. And it needs about 50,000 of points to actually start sampling from the actual density. So basically, you need to discard this number of points anyway. So you see, in principle, this is larger, but they're roughly on the same scale. But then since the conditional distribution sample produces independent points, the error here is much lower. So in terms of the number of points, it's by half an order of magnitude lower. And in terms of CPU time, it's even there is even larger difference because the conditional distribution sample can be done in parallel. And any working MCMC has to go sequentially because it has to produce another point and then accept or reject it. Potentially, you can parallelize it as well by considering multiple chains simultaneously, but if you consider plain vanilla implementation, there is an intrinsically sequential algorithm, and that's why even the simple MATLAB vectorization that we use at the moment can give you like a couple of orders difference in the CPU time if you go at the same accuracy. So far, so good. Yeah, so basically, if you want to get out a single message of this is that sometimes you really need to merge two methodologies, probably entirely different methodologies, and then you can have some very good things out of there. And in particular, if you can use the tensor product surrogate models, you can assist the classical Markov chain Monte Carlo techniques heavily. So you can really exploit the strong sides of both. So there is a preprint on solving the forward stochastic PDE model. The inverse problem, well, there is some, it's almost ready. There is some mess going on about polishing the text, so I can't tell you when exactly it will be done, but I hope soon enough. And with that, I would like to thank you for listening.